All right, Bernie, all you, 15 minutes.
Okay, I have a handout here. Does everybody have a handout? Okay, there's extras over here if you need one. I do that so you can take notes and jog your memory when it's question and answer time. Okay, is faith in God warranted? Of course, I would say, of course not. It's not warranted. I mean, I think God is an imaginary character, just like Darth Vader or Harry Potter. You know, the stories that are written about him. So is faith in Darth Vader warranted? Of course not. So for me, it's the same exact level to talk about God, especially the God of the Bible, Yahweh, Jehovah, Jesus. You know, it doesn't matter if it's Zeus, Thor, whatever. Especially the God of the Bible, even more so. And then, of course, there's different kind of gods. There's a philosopher's God, the deist God. So I'm going to try to focus pretty much on Phil's God here, the Christian God. First off, I want to mention points of agreement. Now, some of my things I'm going to say that some of my fellow atheists would probably disagree with. And so that's fine. I'll give you another viewpoint. One thing is, I'm going to give you the definition of faith from the dictionary, Oxford Dictionary. Some positive aspects of faith. I do believe there are some positive and negative expressions of faith. And I'm going to make the claim that faith can be in line with evidence in some cases. And people can place faith in the wrong things. So for definition, this is the Oxford English Dictionary. Number one, complete trust or confidence in someone or something. Like, this restores one faith in politicians. Or you can say, this restores my faith in God. So that's kind of what we're talking about. That's part of it. Another second definition is strong belief in God or in the doctrines of a religion that are based on spiritual apprehension rather than proof. And this is, I think, what Phil was mentioning, spiritual apprehension, this feeling of having Jesus in your heart. So, for example, the Christian faith. Well, I don't really think we're not talking about the Christian faith. We're not talking about faith in that way. But another version of this was, for example, it says a strongly held belief or theory such as the faith that life will expand until it fills the universe. There are some people that think that life is so forward biased that someday life will spread through the entire universe, and that's their faith. You know, they have faith in that. So that's kind of, I think, the kind of faith we're talking about here too. Okay. So I want to mention what I think are some positive aspects of faith. At work, one time we worked on a very difficult project. Everybody, all the engineers thought it was impossible. And in fact, we use this language to begin with, that it was impossible. And then I noticed that the engineers' language changed. Instead of saying impossible, they said, this is a challenging problem. And I thought, why are they saying it's challenging? Why don't they just say it's impossible? And then it dawned on me, it's like, you know, if I was the manager and they said it's impossible, why shouldn't I fire them and hire somebody else that says, sure, I can do it? So, and it turned out on this project, it was a big project. It was kind of a moonshot type of project. And it panned out, and it made it my company a lot of money. And you know, after thinking about this, I also realized there are some cases where small projects have failed too. But anyway, I just want to say this is a positive aspect of faith. If you really believe, like Obama, you know, when he's running for president, who are you? You're a young guy, you're inexperienced, you're barely a senator, you'll never be president. And if he has a faith in himself to go and do all this stuff, that he can make it, look what happens, he became president, all because he had faith in himself. There's no facts for this, he had to move out on faith. So faith can be very powerful in a positive way. And faith can be in line with evidence. And sometimes there's people, some of the scientists joke that, this is a quote attributed to Max Planck, one of the great scientists. He said, science advances one funeral at a time. This is because some of the scientists can't give up on their hypothesis, even when it's been proven wrong. So, you know, a scientist should be impartial, and when his hypothesis is falsified, he should move on. But sometimes they like their hypothesis so much that they'll cling on to it. And sometimes that's good, because sometimes it looks like there is disconfirming evidence, but later on more evidence does come in to support it, and then they can figure out why that disconfirming evidence is explainable, because maybe there's other things they've learned that explains it now. So, you know, so there is faith in science, in your hypothesis. I don't see anything wrong with that. Unless it's to the extreme where you should drop it and you don't because of your faith. So people can place faith in the wrong things. Hopefully this is something that Phil would agree with. You know, this is his own group I'm talking about. This is all, I mean, he says he's a Christian. He associates with Christians. Let me tell you what some of the most famous Christians on TV do. There's this guy, one guy named Peter Popoff. You know, he was disqualified and he's back on paid TV now. But, you know, here's an advertisement. The Lord's time for canceling debts has been proclaimed, Deuteronomy 15. You know, so call for your free miracle spring water and your anointed faith tool. Is faith in God warranted? Well, here's a faith tool. You can get a faith tool. I mean, it could be a cloth that's anointed or something. Look how they distort this. And I hope Phil has a righteous anger about this. He should. Because, I mean, this is destroying the Christian faith because it's such nonsense. Here's another example on TBN. I mean, maybe the Christians should get together and put all their money and put it into TV and proclaim the gospel. Well, that's what they're doing on TBN. And here they got people on their fundraising. It says, a preacher exhorted viewers to bellow, "Fear not," three times, count down from 10, and then rush to the phone with donations. In exchange, he said they would receive a miracle from God about this time tomorrow. Within seconds, all 200 phone lines were busy. This is Christians putting their money in the preaching of the gospel, and this is what they're doing. Again, Phil should be upset about this. He should be very incensed about this, but I don't ever sense this from any of the Christian leaders and professors. People place faith, you know, in this holy scriptures. What holy scriptures? Well, the Bhagavad Gita, or the Holy Quran, or the Book of Mormon, or the Holy Bible. You know, it's all the same, right? They just have different degree of claims they're making. This is I said that, you know, they can place their faith in wrong things like imaginary and invisible characters, and here is God. You know, and I'm using this, you know, because sometimes atheists make fun of Christians. They say, "Oh, I don't believe in Sky Daddy." And Christians say, "Why do you say Sky Daddy? That's that's just mocking us." And it's like, well, look at this stained glass. Looks like there's this, you know, Father God in heaven above the clouds. There's the Holy Spirit there, and that's either God the Father or Jesus up there in the sky. You know, that's what happened in Acts. Jesus ascended up into the sky, up into heaven, past the clouds. What? That's where heaven was. They said that's where heaven was, up there past the clouds. And that's why the story says he ascended up to heaven. And the angel said, you know what? Jesus is going to return from heaven the same way he's going to return from the sky. Okay, well, nowadays, of course, Christians don't say heaven's up there in the sky. I mean, some might. I know there's some Christians who still think hell is literally in the belly of the earth. I mean, look at, you got molten, you know, metals there. That's hotter than hell, you know. That's must be where hell is. But nowadays, Christians say, oh, you know, heaven and hell are different dimensions, you know. Well, you know, Acts wasn't written with that in mind. So why is faith in God not warranted? I'll give four reasons here, and I'll go into details. Can you see how much time I got? If you can keep that on, it's kind of nice for me. I can kind of watch it. So the burden of proof is on the claimant. I'm going to explain what that means. But there's a burden of proof is a philosophical concept. The null hypothesis is a scientific concept. Extraordinary claims require extraordinary evidence. It's a nice proverb, and it's kind of that's more of a philosophical concept for logical thinking, critical thinking, same with the burden of proof. God evidences are usually guilty of being logical fallacies. That's my claim. Logical fallacies are a major component that they teach you in critical thinking. So that's a philosophy thing. So let me talk about the burden of proof. It's on the claimant. So which religion of all competing religions is true? You know, a lot of Christians, they're like, hey, accept Jesus. It's like either Jesus or nothing. You know, either an atheist or you believe in Jesus. Wait a minute. Look at the whole smorgasbord. I mean, if you were born in Iran, people might think it was Islam or nothing. You know, or if you're in India, maybe it was Hinduism or nothing. But you got all these religions to compare. So why don't you treat them all as an equal opportunity? And John Loftus is a guy, he's a former Christian too, and he says, Jesus, outsiders test the faith. Test each one of these as an outsider, not like a believer of one of them that has confirmation bias and wants to prefer his own. Step outside and look at them all equally and say, which one makes the most sense? If you're going to make a claim, the burden of proof is on you. If I say I have a million zebras living in my garage and, you know, you want to buy one? They're only $1,000 each. I mean, why would you buy one if you don't go take a look at it? And why would you even believe them if I said I had a million of them? Because obviously I can't have a million in my garage, you know? So if I'm going to make a claim, I should have a burden of proof. And that's why we need logic and reason to sort it out. You can't just say, go by your feelings. Come on, you don't believe me I have 1,000 zebras in my garage? See what your heart tells you. Come on, pray about it. That's God. No, you don't go, you don't appeal to your emotions like that. Would I lie to you? Come on, what kind of feelings do you get here? That's what a mass murderer would say, or somebody, you know, it's like, hey, come on to my house. You know, I'm a nice guy. Yeah, okay, you got a nice feeling? What is the null hypothesis? The null hypothesis is a very interesting scientific concept. A lot of scientists don't even know about this, but the null hypothesis is the standard hypothesis. And when you create a new hypothesis, your goal is actually supposed to be to overturn the null hypothesis. So for example, at one point, let me give you, there's various ways of looking at this, but one of the most obvious ways is like, if I say, here's a pill, this will cure cancer, pay me $1,000 for it, okay? The null hypothesis is, this does not cure cancer. If you want to overcome that null hypothesis, you have to show with statistics, through testing, double-blind testing, placebo, that my pill is better than a placebo. Otherwise, I have not beaten the null hypothesis, okay? So the null hypothesis, me and Phil agree there's a natural world. We agree that if I drop this, it's gonna fall to the ground. That's all natural. But he wants to go, somebody might go over more than that and say, no, there's really angels that bring that down, and someday they may bring it up, you know? And it's like, well, okay, if you have these additional supernatural things, then you should try to beat the null hypothesis. They can't beat the null hypothesis, because whenever you put a camera or anything on it, it's all natural. The whole system is working natural. There's no miracles that can be captured on film or tape or testing or anything. Prayer studies, anything you name, anything you try to test fails when it comes to supernatural. Extraordinary claims require extraordinary evidence. There's a famous person that says you should apportion belief to evidence. The more the evidence, the more you can believe it, okay? If you want me to believe you're an American citizen, no problem. It doesn't really ask much of me. I can believe that, okay? But if you want me to believe that you're a prophet that talks to God, and God told you to tell me something, and I need to change my life based on that, I'm sorry, but you're going to have to give me some evidence, okay? So, you know, the extraordinary claims require extraordinary evidence. The more you claim, the more you want from me, the more you better prove it, okay? And it's not going to be just ask me how I feel about my heart. And one of my claims is that God evidences are usually guilty of being logical fallacies, appeal to emotion. This is a huge one. This is the core of Phil's argument tonight about feelings. I used to be a Christian. I had the feelings. I thought I was led by God. I thought I had a relationship with Jesus. That's why I said I didn't want to give this up. I now know it's a delusion. Just like it's a delusion if you're in a desert and you see an oasis. Yeah, you see that. You really do see it. But it's not true. It's not real. I've had that delusion. Whatever feel, if Phil says he feels the Holy Spirit, I felt it. I know exactly what he's talking about. And that's why I didn't want to give it up. I wanted it. I said, just give me one thread. And I could not, after learning science and philosophy, I could not find one thread to hold on to. What all, Phil just has logical fallacies. The appeal to emotion is the biggest worst one right here on display. He also mentioned the appeal to ignorance. Why is there something instead of nothing? We don't know. Therefore, it's evidence for God. No, it's not evidence for God. It's evidence you don't know. It's not evidence for either side. It's another major logical fallacy. And so that's the appeal to ignorance. And then there's just poor arguments. I'm going to skip that one because I think I'm running out of time here. I might get back to that. So in conclusion, I would say I was a born-again evangelical Christian for over 25 years. Before that, I was raised a Roman Catholic. I was confirmed as a Roman Catholic. But the last 25 years, up until 2009, I was a born-again evangelical Christian. Working full-time in the computer industry the whole time on the side. Did an internet Christian ministry, preached the gospel on TV, cable TV, and all that stuff. The more I learned about science and philosophy, I came to see that the naturalistic worldview made sense of everything. When you're a Christian, you're going to say, well, how do you explain the problem of evil? And you know, there's so many problems in Christianity and theology because it doesn't make sense. And the answer is always, well, someday we'll go to heaven and find out. Well, when you have a naturalistic worldview, kabam, it all makes sense. Seriously, I don't have any philosophical contradictions whatsoever. And in Christianity, it's just loaded left and right. So anyway, I see belief in God as a God delusion. I'm here to break the spell. I hope that I helped get you guys out of that too. And I want to encourage you to seek truth more than no matter what, higher than anything else. Let the consequences fall, but we don't want to believe in Santa Claus just because it makes us feel good. We don't want to believe in God just because it makes us feel good.
I'm going to do the same thing I did for you, Bernie, mm-hmm. but I did for Phil, and if you could kind of succinctly just to cover that last 15 minutes, but
sure.
maybe as close as you can to a sentence or a couple sentences, why is faith in God not warranted?
Okay, yeah, the reason why faith in God is not warranted is because, number one, there is no evidence for it, and number two, the evidence presented for it by people like Phil tonight are logical fallacies.
All right, guys, there's probably plenty to chew through right down for both of them that you may agree or disagree with.